Hello and welcome back to our crypto adventure. I'm Natalie Stoberman, joined by the amazing Billy Farrington. And Billy, it's so good to see you again and so great to be back.
Yeah, it's been too long, Nat. It's lovely to see you again. Where have you been hiding away all these weeks and months?
Well, you know, crypto was pretty boring for a minute there, and I just came back once there was something spicy to talk about.
Which there absolutely is, isn't there?
Yes, of course. Oh my gosh. This has been a wild time in cryptocurrency, with probably one of the most high stakes trials in anything financial related in a very long time. Sam Bankman-Fried, we're on day four of his trial with the FTX collapse, and what is it, seven basically fraud charges across wire fraud and conspiring to commit fraud and all that fun stuff. And day four, the first few days have been interesting. I know you've been following it with a magnifying glass, but it's just been so interesting to see how many people, or sorry, the witnesses that have come forward already, and they've blatantly said that FTX defrauded its customers. What is your take so far on how this has been unfolding? We are still in the very beginning of this trial.
Yes. So the most high profile witness so far has been Gary Wang, who was one of the co-founders of FTX back in the day. And he acted as a chief financial officer alongside Sam Bankman-Fried. Now, just for a recap, he basically instantly rolled over when these charges came to light. He admitted, guilty. I'm guilty of fraud, manipulation, and everything that's basically been leveled against Sam Bankman-Fried now. So it really took nothing for him to roll over and basically throw his ex-colleague under the bus. So he's been on the stand the last couple of days, and he hasn't minced his words. He's basically said, you know, there's this narrative around Sam Bankman-Fried. Oh, he was a bit of a goofball. He didn't know what he was doing. He dropped the ball. He was too young, inexperienced, you know, bit of a silly fool, but he's not some, you know, evil, you know, mastermind, fraud mastermind.
Please, that's Billy, the guy went to MIT. He's no dummy.
Absolutely right. So that's the narrative that obviously his lawyers want to paint for us, the public, and the jury. Now, the first major witness, Gary Wang, he basically said this is ridiculous. Like, you know, fraud was endemic in FTX. He signed off on these, you know, backdoor money flows out of FTX into sister company
Alameda, right?
Yeah, that's it. Basically, he just was really trying to, and as a witness, and you know, he's got his reputation, what's left of it, on the line as well. He really just wanted to pretty much tell the jury, look, don't fall for this goofball narrative. He kind of knew what he was doing. I was right there next to him. So that's basically been my take of his testimony. And I mean, you can read it for yourselves as well. That, you know, in the trial, they did that classic thing of in this room, do you see someone who committed fraud in this room? I can't remember the exact terminology, but you know, to that extent. And you know,
so Gary dramatic.
Yeah, exactly right. Like you see in the films, and Gary Wang was looking around, and it, you know, he puts his eyes on Bankman-Fried, and he's like, "Yeah, that guy." So, pretty damning evidence from his very close former colleague. Then again, Gary Wang, you know, already guilty of fraud and manipulation. So, how much is his word worth? Who knows? But he's only one of many witnesses that are going to be on this trial, as you said, one of those high profile trials, not just. Well, definitely in crypto, but you know, just in the financial crime space ever, really. I mean, it's a big deal.
So, not to interrupt you, Billy, but two things stand out. First of all, I love the fact that you use the word reputation for Gary Wang.
Oh, sure, yeah.
There's no such thing as that anymore.
Oh no.
First of all, and second of all, there's actually a really funny point. So, I was listening to a podcast just about the trial, and apparently CoinDesk, they went out into Manhattan, into the financial district, basically doing streeters, asking people on the street what they think of the trial, how much they know about cryptocurrency. Majority of the people they spoke to, this is CoinDesk, this is one of the bigger cryptocurrency media outlets. in the financial district in freaking Manhattan, which they said majority of the people had no idea about cryptocurrency. And they had no idea about FTX and no idea about Sam Bankman-Fried.
Really? Wow.
And that strikes me because this came out also when they were doing the jury selection. So I could only imagine, what kind of a rock do you have to live under? Not even a black rock. Like, everyone in finance is trying to get their hands in crypto, especially now in this bear market. So I just find that so hard to believe. But to your point, when it comes to Gary Wang, pardon me, I had a little bit of a cold. So, you know, we'll sound way better next week. But I just find it so odd that you have three of the four co-founders of FTX, basically half the people living in this crazy ass mansion in Bahamas that Lord knows what the heck happened there. We've all heard stories of incredible orgies, drug use. You got that kind of money, you're doing some crazy shit in a mansion with nine other people. I just find it so funny that three of the four co-founders pled guilty already. And here we are with Sam, with SBF going to trial. And in that podcast, I believe I heard, and I could be wrong, but I believe I heard that the Department of Justice, they were asked whether or not a plea deal was on the table for Sam Bankman-Fried. And apparently there wasn't. I'm really curious if they're just taking one person. They're like, okay, we're going to shoot our shot on Sam and make an example out of him.
Yeah.
And I'm really curious also how this could impact the crypto markets, which right now I feel like it's not having that much of an impact, even though the last few weeks were pretty shaky. And we'll talk about Bitcoin spot prices in a bit, but there's just a lot of head scratchers around this whole thing because we're trying to figure out with this trial what level of intent that Sam Bankman-Fried had when it came to defrauding the FTX customers and basically trying to pay off billions of debt for Alameda and trying to do a shell game with that. So how do you feel about where this trial could lead?
Well, see, I think it's more than just SBF on the stand here. I think it's all of his enablers as well. You know, let's not forget, you had, it's funny, you talk about Manhattan and they're like, what's FTX? I mean, you had like Sequoia and all these, you know, big money players that, you know, were proselytizing Sam Bankman-Fried as the second coming of Christ, basically. Mm. And you had high profile media celebrities like Kevin O'Leary, Tom Brady, and all that. A lot of these people, even after these allegations came to light, you know, kind of stood by him, and many kind of still do. You got Michael Lewis, the guy who wrote Moneyball and The Big Short. He just released a book basically praising the life out of Sam Bankman-Fried. He was on 60 Minutes a couple of nights ago, you know, still defending him. So you have all these enablers that, you know, allegedly were backing this alleged fraudster. And it's their reputation on the line as well, isn't it? Because it seems like everybody fell for this guy. Some admitted to being kind of blindsided by his charms. I suppose he had charms. Who knows? But there are, you know,
I find that highly unlikely.
Yeah. So I mean, to the point though, it's like it's. I feel like it's not just him on trial. It's the sort of the industry and the institutions that were behind this guy all along. They didn't do their due diligence. So that is something that is going to be in the public conscious as well throughout this trial, I think. So that's going to be a really interesting dynamic. And it also leads to that question. It's like, I'll ask you this. I mean, how did this guy, Sam Bankman-Fried, interesting fella, smart fella, how did he manage to sort of allegedly dupe so many people, not just the average Joe on the street, but huge, high-profile financial institutions, massive celebrities, Tom Brady, Larry David. What was it about him? Because I'm still so curious. What was it about Sam Bankman-Fried that made everybody just lose their minds? Because I'm still trying to figure that out, Nat.
Yeah. It's like the Pied Piper, and everyone's like, take my money. Take my money. I that's a great question. I feel like the best way to answer that is that ignorance is bliss.
Yeah.
And you go after celebrities. And so here's where I'm going to preface this. You have to go after celebrities that are all about the dollar signs.
Yeah, yeah.
And Tom Brady, nobody wants to single out Tom Brady, but he's, I feel like he's a pretty savvy businessman. And he's been working with Bitcoin for the last little while. Like he gave a fan one whole Bitcoin to get back his record-breaking touchdown football when he was playing. So he's no, I don't feel like that was the layer of ignorance that went over or pulled the wool over so many celebrities' eyes. I feel like because they just don't know enough about the blockchain technology, because really, like, the testimony from Bankman-Fried's former friend, Adam Yedida, who used to work with FTX and also on the Alameda side, he came out saying that this was a code that was very difficult to track. That a set of code that was written for Alameda to be able to withdraw an unlimited amount of money from directly customers from money. This is the scary part, directly from FTX customer wallets. That is scary AF. That it's very simple to do, and somebody, so this is where the basically the scales are tipping. Is Sam Bankman-Fried a goofball that just got lucky and made a crap ton of money and put his MIT degree to decent use for a minute? Or is this a guy that saw opportunity because of how early on we are in cryptocurrency? And there's a lot of people that are very naive. Like Shaq, you think Shaq is going to know anything about blockchain technology and the code and the ledger that goes behind all the transactions and withdrawals that like I wouldn't even know. And I'm no wizard, but I mean, I follow
the fundamentals.
It's all about the fundamentals and the research that you do. So a lot of times, like, you're going to get the marketing, be like, oh, this, we're going to be the biggest crypto exchange in the United States.
People see the dollar signs. Yeah,
exactly. And I remember reading, this was a while ago, how Taylor Swift avoided getting swept up in that.
Was interesting. Yeah.
Yes, like it was on CNBC and everything, and it was like Taylor Swift said no to the worst opportunity ever, and I'm just like, interesting. Somebody had to have been looking out for her and be like, you just, I can't remember the full reason why, because now I'm just thinking about this.
Well, when you think of savvy business people, Taylor Swift is really up there, to be honest. I mean, she is kind of a marketing genius, and she's kind of a music industry genius. I mean, she is one clever woman, and I think she might have just seen through his bullshit. Simple as that.
Yeah, somebody had to have seen through it. Somebody had to have known. So that's the thing. You have one big celebrity and a pool of many others. And I'm just singling out celebrities here because you need to surround yourself with very intelligent people to protect your wealth if you're a celebrity. If you're not doing that, you won't have your name or your wealth for very long, especially now. Yeah. And I'm just surprised when it comes to business deals. It's so early in the space that how would you know? Like, not the people that work there knew. And then his friend Adam Yedida, which I thought was very telling. Like, he flipped once he got the confirmation from a developer within FTX that this happened. And this was the guy that lived in the mansion with him, even with the Michael Lewis, the author, which I think that's so much drama. There's got to be so much, like, I don't care what anybody says. If you're dropping a book right when a trial starts that you're involved in, that there's some, you know, there's some capitalization there that, you know, we're not letting this opportunity go by. And can you blame the guy? Maybe, maybe not.
Let's not forget that it wasn't just celebrities taking FTX money as well. I mean, there are hundreds of YouTube channels, you know, finance YouTube channels that FTX was giving them a lot of money to, like, promote them. So, you know, there were a lot of FTX's successes did come from this quite grassroots, organic kind of word of mouth, you know, YouTube and Instagram and Twitter based grassroots marketing and advertising, which FTX was willing to give, like, a lot of these small and big channels a large sum of money to say, this video was brought to you by FTX, go to FTX and get 5% off your next crypto trade or whatever it was. So let's not forget, it wasn't just these massive celebrities and financial institutions taking money. It was just people like you and me as well that were willing to promote it. But, you know,
non-celebrities.
Yeah, exactly. But there's another conversation there about influencers and, you know, what are their responsibilities? Like, what are their financial fiduciary responsibilities? And I think that is something that really needs to be looked into, because, you know, you need to take responsibility for the, in my opinion, you need to take responsibility for the things that you advertise, or at least do your due diligence before kind of just advertising what could actually be out, turn out to be a massive financial fraud. So yeah, I mean, it was everyone sort of falling for his shtick by the sounds of it. I mean, I didn't have the pleasure of being asked to take any of his money to promote anything. So woe is me.
Thank goodness.
Yeah.
Lord have mercy. It's just like, it's not a cut and dry thing. I anticipate as like Sam Bankman-Fried having the book thrown at him, because the DOJ, there's probably other institutions within the US that are like, okay, we looked really bad looking at USCC. We looked really bad, and you need to make an example out of this guy. But really, like, what could he get between 10 to 20 years? I feel like that is not enough.
I think by some accounts, it's like if he's found guilty on all of these charges, it's like multiple life sentences.
Yeah, like I'm hearing different things. So, I mean, life sentence should be like the minimum, because the amount of money that so many people lost and they entrusted into this institution, like they probably had their lives ruined. I can't even imagine. Like, this is so somber to think about, but the amount of people that either contemplated or actually did decide to like take their life because they felt so ruined and like, I don't want to know.
The real victims, yeah.
The sad part is that this isn't the first time.
Nope.
Here in Canada, quadriga is like the freaking Old Testament to nonsense like this. And thank God that they didn't, that the DOJ or the judge in the case did not allow Sam Bankman-Fried to be let out of jail for the beginning of this trial, because his lawyers are like, we need to talk to him all the time. Use a phone. I don't care. This is 2023, because the guy could have went to India to fake his death.
Yeah, yeah. And can we just take a second to look back on what an amazing time it's been for court hawks recently? You had Johnny Depp, Amber Heard. You had Gwyneth Paltrow's insane thing with the skiing incident, which was just incredible. And then you got this, sadly not being televised, probably not enough sort of wider public interest, but still a super high stakes, really just engrossing tale of courtroom drama. I mean, it's the golden age of courtroom drama by the sounds of it at the
moment. My God, Court TV is going to be having content come out of their ears and money coming out of their ass.
I will say, though, obviously this is a lot, the stakes are a lot higher here, and it's a lot more kind of serious, isn't it, because there's so much money at stake. Not to say that the previous cases weren't so serious, but you know, this is stuff on the level of Wirecard and global financial crisis in terms of just how much alleged manipulation was at stake. So people tend to look at crypto as like it's not the real world. That's probably why people in Manhattan were like, never heard of it, because people think of crypto as not the real world. Then people aren't losing real money, they're losing magic internet beans, you know, it's not real money. But it's not the case, though. It is people's money, it's people's livelihoods, it's people's actual bank accounts, and many people have gone bankrupt because of this situation, whether it's through fraud or just simple mishandling. So yes, we can all kind of laugh sometimes at the ridiculousness of the situation, but yeah, it still very much is it's a very sad story at the same time.
Very sad. And mishandling, you hit the nail on the head. There was definitely a lot of mishandling that had to have gone into something like this. But do you feel that if this came to trial during a bull market, that this would have a different effect on the outlook of what's been happening within the crypto space?
I would suggest that it probably never would have happened in a bull market, because I guess one of the reasons why he allegedly got caught with his hand in the pot was because it was a bear market and they were just losing money hand over fist. So I guess if the market was still going up, the FTX would have still been liquid enough, and they wouldn't have been losing money on all these silly market bets that they were doing. So there's the case of saying that this might not have even happened in the bull market, and it's the bear market that caused the end of FTX. But you know, putting that aside, What if this happened during a bull market? I mean, you'd like to think that it would receive the same amount of scrutiny and condemnation, really. Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure how much of a difference that would have made, but there are certainly a lot fewer villains in the crypto space when things were on the up, weren't there? Now you've got what? Alex Mashinsky, you got Sam Bankman-Fried, you got all these others.
Kwan.
Yeah, all of them, Suzu and all that. I mean, it's just been the year of crypto, the last two years of crypto villains, and no one's a villain when the market's up. Nah.
No, you're right.
When everyone's earning money hand over fist, no one's a villain. When the market goes down and people, you see who's swimming without their trunks on, and that's when the real villains come to light. And that's what happened in the crypto market in 2022. And that's why we're seeing these crazy trials at the moment.
Yeah, you're so right. This is the year of crypto villains and courtroom drama.
Yeah.
So on that note, Billy, we're talking about bear and bull markets. Let's shift our gears to Bitcoin for a moment before we wrap up, because we're going to be talking about this case for a long time. And let's face it, I think we know what's going to happen. It's more so what's going to come out that's going to be the jaw-dropping moments or the eye-openers.
Carolyn Ellison, when she gets on the stage.
Oh, my God.
Let's talk about that because there's too much to say about it.
Oh, my God. I cannot wait for next Friday already, because that's going to be a good one. That's going to be a doozy, because I've read some transcripts of interviews with her. She was not all there. And this is going back a few years. Okay. So, all right, let's dial in here. Just look at Bitcoin spot prices for a moment. Yep. Bitcoin seems to be a lot healthier than it was in the start of September, or once, fall was coming in. Mm-hmm. I mean, what are we looking at here? About 27K, mid 27K US. Yep. And in the last 2 weeks to 30 days, we're still looking at gains between 3% and 7%.
Yeah, it's interesting. There's sort of been a reverse trend the last couple of months. So everyone likes to talk about the September, but September, and it's true. September has been the historically the worst month on record for Bitcoin, right? Mm-hmm. That didn't happen. Bitcoin had a net positive September, quite a net positive September, traded pretty well. Usually, people say after September comes the October. Well, that's not happened. Bitcoin has sort of plateaued a bit following a pretty decent September. But as you said, it's in the mid 27K range. Yes, it has dropped back a little bit on the spot markets, but it's still in a relatively healthy position, if you ask me. Mm-hmm. It's looking pretty strong, especially, against the wider crypto space and against Ethereum as well. So yeah, Bitcoin looking healthy in the mid 27K range. If anyone who's interested in reading the tea leaves, I could say that the 200-day moving average is, serving a bit of a resistance point right now. So we saw Bitcoin get rejected at the 200-day trend line twice this week. So, and that's around the 28K mark. So that's probably the resistance point that we're looking at Bitcoin right now. That could be the real sticking point. That might be difficult for the bears to sort of break above that. So in the meantime, we might see a bit of a sideways trade around this sort of 27 to 28K range. But hey, to be honest, that's really not too bad, because we were looking at, 16K earlier this year. So yeah, that's Bitcoin looking pretty healthy. Bitcoin dominance is actually has increased as well. Like Ethereum has not fared very well. The second largest cryptocurrency, Ethereum, that is on the down, as is pretty much the wider altcoin space, apart from a few outliers. So a lot of sort of consolidation in the market toward Bitcoin by the looks of it, for a few reasons, I guess. Bond market's down, the equities market is down. I think maybe people are just looking to sort of hedge their bets a little bit, and Bitcoin is ostensibly a more safer option than some altcoins with lower trading volumes, liquidity, and worse fundamentals. So that's my take on the market, Nat.
That's a great take. I agree with everything that you're saying, and you're right. We are looking at a bit of a sea of red when it comes to the altcoin contingent. Mm-hmm. But hey, that's what Bitcoin is for. Bitcoin is kind of that safe haven in times of need. And realistically, going into the end of a year, you're not going to see a lot of big moves in the crypto space. I mean, not like a crypto winter, especially when you're going into a halving year. But no, I'm excited to see what the next from now until the spring and leading up into the Bitcoin halving. I'm excited to see how that will shape up, especially people who have been keeping their eye on Bitcoin cycles. I also feel to an extent that Bitcoin over time has been shifting away from certain trends just because it's gaining a lot more strength on its own and sort of leaving that decoupling behind little by little, right?
That is also very true.
So
maybe there's a, maybe there's a Santa rally on the way. Who knows? Yeah. We'll see. That'd be fun, wouldn't it?
Wouldn't it? You better write your letters to Santa Claus now.
Yeah. Put your wishes in, folks.
And of course, we can't go without talking about spot Bitcoin ETFs and even Ethereum, spot Ethereum ETFs and Grayscale trying to get their hat in the ring for that one again. Where are we standing on that this week?
Yeah, that's been a real big talking point in the last, well, I mean, ever since 2015, Grayscale has been trying to get a spot Bitcoin ETF through the US regulators, Gary Gensler, SEC, right? You know, the boogeyman. It's really ramped up the last couple of months, though. So it's not just Grayscale. We've had Wisdom Tree, Kathy Wood,
BlackRock,
for God's sake. I mean, you know, these massive institutions. BlackRock's the largest asset manager on the planet. These massive institutions pushing for a spot Bitcoin ETF. For those who, you know, wondering what is that, it means you would actually be able to own Bitcoin on the stock market and own it that way, as opposed to having to go through, you know, the finicky issues.
Yeah, custodian, like being actual, like having a custodial wallet and all that stuff. Yeah. There's a little bit of a buffer.
So essentially, it will just open up Bitcoin to far wider market of institutional grade investors. I think one statistic I heard was a former BlackRock executive said it could add $200 billion of liquidity to the Bitcoin market. You know, that's who knows how much it is. But what is for sure is that it 100% will increase Bitcoin's exposure to the traditional finance sector. And that could really only be a good thing, to be honest. You would think for the price of Bitcoin. But that said, you know, the SEC has just not approved any of these yet. They've been pretty stern in saying no, the Bitcoin market's too prone to manipulation and misuse of funds. I mean, I think that's a kind of stupid argument because
it is.
You can there are already futures Bitcoin ETFs on the market. So you're saying the futures market isn't full of fraud and manipulation, but the spot market, it just doesn't weigh up to me. But there's been so much more pressure against the SEC to say, like, pull your head out of your ass. This is a genuine asset class that people want to be able to trade on the stock exchange. Just get over yourself and approve it. I think that's the narrative coming out against them. There's going to be more and more kind of legal challenges against them. And I think they might be strong-armed into saying, all right, fine, you can have your spot Bitcoin ETF. So, I mean, I think that is probably on the cards. Who knows? But that's my guess is that in the next year or so, we'll probably start seeing these approved.
Yep, it's got to happen. But I feel like timing could be everything. Like, this has been this isn't new. Like, this isn't 2023 thing. This has been ongoing for, oh my gosh, like you said, since 2015. So, nobody in this space beyond the FTX trial is unaware of what could be taking place next year. So it's all about timing, I feel like. And all of these institutions, like BlackRock especially, they've been working with the SEC and have been in the business with writing proposals for new projects and new funds for decades. So
It's also BlackRock kind of knows how the game works more than Grayscale as well. They know what to say. They know who's back to scratch and all this sort of stuff that we'll never be privy to. SEC just shrugs off Grayscale because SEC is like, who the hell's Grayscale? I don't care about you. They can't really do that to BlackRock that has $10 trillion of assets under management. So, I mean, just having that institutional power behind the push for these ETFs, in my mind, just makes it more of an inevitability.
Yeah, I like that. And let's end on that. Inevitability
right.
sounds about right to me. For everyone watching, feel free to comment in on your thoughts on the FTX trial. Also, how you feel about the likely inevitability of a spot Bitcoin and spot Ethereum ETF finally making its way into the stock market. And if you have anything else that you'd like us to discuss,
comments.
Just drop it in the comments. And now that we're back, let's make it happen.
Awesome.
Billy, if I could go to the UK just to give you and our homeboy Sergio a hug, I would.
It'll happen in the pub one day, trust me.
Oh my God. And no phones, no cameras.
No, none of that. Yeah, no. You don't want that stuff, going online. Who knows what the cameras might pick up if we actually ever get together in the end? You know what I mean?
Lord of mercy. Good Lord. Okay, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. And we'll see you again next time for the crypto adventure.
See ya.